I love your story from Incursion, and I've really been looking forward to having this story as a part of Dial the Gate. The pulsar that Destiny falls out of hyperspace into nearby. Please tell us about this story.
All right.
This is so fascinating. This is like, this is why the Stargate is ahead of its time.
All right. So the idea was we needed an astrophysical big baddie to kill everybody every 22 minutes. And the original idea was have a pulsar. Well, pulsars are like lighthouses of death. Every time they whirl around, they send out high energy particles out one side, out their axes, and it's like, it just kills everyone in its wake. Great, fantastic. But normal pulsars go so fast that we're talking milliseconds. And if you slowed it down so much that was the beam was passing by every 22 minutes, it would be about as deadly as holding fridge magnets and doing cartwheels. Yes, it would generate an electromagnetic field. No, nobody would care. Nobody would even notice. Like, even if you were to have like a pacemaker and were standing directly in the beam, you'd be like, what? Didn't notice. So that's a problem, because your astrophysical big baddie actually has to kill people in order for it to be scary. Technicalities don't work. So we went, all right, what if instead we had a pulsar that was starving? So it was just on the verge of having enough mass to be able to generate those high energy beams, but not quite. But it had a companion star. It had a big gas giant, and it was a binary system. The stars were rotating around each other. And when the feeder star was close enough, the pulsar would gobble, snap, munch it all up, get enough mass, start generating the beam, kill, 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 die, 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 all of that. And then that feeder star would go just out of range. The pulsar would use up that mass through generating its beam and go quiescent, go quiet again. And then that star would come back around, it'd eat, we'd have the big death. Great, excellent. Small problem. Never seen a system like this anywhere in the universe. But there's no reason why there couldn't be one.
It could exist, but we just haven't observed it. Yeah,
exactly. We're like, well, we've seen all sorts of other binary systems. We've seen like black holes and binary systems with pulsars. We've seen neutron stars, in orbit around each other. We've had like red giants hanging out with other stuff. Like, we've seen all sorts of combinations. Why not? Let's just do it. So we did. The episode aired. Couple years later, researchers found a system just like this in real life. And instead of calling it the Stargate system, which seriously they should have, they called it a Black Widow star. So it's a Black Widow pulsar that is slowly consuming its companion. And instead of being 22 minutes, it's every 6 minutes. But aside from that, it's our system. It's our baby. We did it in Stargate first. And then the universe was like, oh yeah, we totally have this. You want to check it out? We had it in the back. Let's just pull it forward to move properly. So I was really proud of that, because we took this little theory, this little idea that we needed for our plot, and it actually showed up in real life. And yeah, it's my pride and joy.
I think it's a testament to how sound the science is, you know? And it's a show, and you've got to make the show work. First and foremost, you got to make the story work, you know,
always,
so that we can fall in love with the characters and the situations that they deal with. But when you create something that later is so consistent to what, you know, is plausible, that it turns out to be true. I mean, we've only seen ones that do this, and we found one that goes 6 minutes now. I mean, that's just crazy. Blows your mind.
I love it. It's the way I always see it is the story is always going to come first. These are shows meant for entertainment. They aren't science documentaries. But the science can exist as a layer of plausibility to support the storyline. That if you have plausible science, that means that your viewers are given nice, strong foundation so they can come along for the ride, and they can save their suspension of disbelief for somewhere where the plot needs it. Then instead of trying to like use up your suspension of disbelief on the gun that never runs out of ammo, you can hold on to it until you have the incredibly improbable coincidental encounter of people talking about vital ideas, right? That you can save it for the parts you actually need it. And in the meantime, by having that plausible consistency, you're building this strong world where everything has a bit more depth to it, a little bit more grounding to it. And that's what I really, really love about doing science consulting. There's so many things I love about it. It's just so much fun.
It's a trip, you know, and you're getting to watch our knowledge unfold and help creative people apply it in ways that it's entertaining.
And so because, I mean, Stargate was my first show, which meant that the cast and crew of Stargate taught me how to be on set and taught me how to be able to work within this film world, because the culture is way different than my science labs or than hanging out at disaster sites or anything like that. So they mentored me and taught me and showed me what does it mean. And I've taken that same culture with me to any other show I work on. One of the things that made Stargate so special is that everybody, cast and crew, are just as curious and excited as you'd hope they were. So we had filming get held up once because I was way too busy explaining the entire history of the universe to Robert Carlyle. Yes! And I got it down. Like, it took me a little bit, but I can now do like a 30-second version of like the entire history of
the elevator pitch of the history of the universe.
Yeah, exactly. Be like, here's how it works. Or there was a scene with David Blue and David Hewitt where Eli and McKay were arguing about something that had nothing to do with the plot.
Right.
I could make it any science argument I wanted. And the actors actually wanted to learn enough about the science to be able to pick which side of the argument they would be on based on their characters. So
their characters.
And I'm just like, oh, you guys make me so happy.
What was that argument? Because it was like, it was not in the forefront of the scene. And I'm trying to remember what the topic was, what they were debating.
We didn't explicitly say, so you had to be able to recognize it wasn't written in the script. It was all visual. And it was about the shape of the universe, which also means the beginning and end of the universe. So how is the universe eventually going to end? Which means, will it expand forever or will it come contracting back down? Which is actually a question of Einstein's greatest mistake. It's a particular character, if you do like the mathematical formulation of the universe. There's like this constant of integration on the end called lambda. And because of the way the math works, you can set it to anything. And Einstein originally set it so the universe never changed, that it was a static universe. And then Hubble started making observations that the universe was expanding, and Einstein went, my greatest mistake. And then we spent all this time since then trying to figure out what lambda is. And it's this like in real life, amazing science story where at one point, a telescope was staring into space and kept having this static on it. And the people on the ground thought that it was pigeon poop. So they actually assigned like people to hang out near the telescope, like scrubbing it out and like hold onto brooms and like chase away the pigeons. And they still had this static. And they're like, oh, what is this? And they figured out it was the static of the microwave background radiation. And if you look at shapes in that, it tells you what lambda is, which turns out then Stargate went down that route of let's look at patterns in the cosmic microwave background radiation. So while it had nothing to do with the plot, it's a little bit of a hint in the teaser that it would have something to do with the plot later on of figuring out what this structure is.
Wow.
So it all ties together.
Thank you for watching this clip from Dial the Gate. If you enjoyed the video, please consider giving us a thumbs up with that like button. It will encourage the algorithm to show this to other Stargate fans. Also, please consider sending this to a fellow Stargate friend. I also want to invite you to subscribe to future episodes right here on YouTube. We are a live show, so changes are likely to happen all the time. And if you plan on joining us live, you'll want to be the first to know. Be sure to visit dialthegate.com for the complete guest schedule so you'll know when to join us and ask your very own questions to our guests. See you on the other side.